Hi, I'm Chase Sharkey with Sharkey Mechanical. Our team of experts handle some of the largest and most complex air conditioning systems in the state. Give us a call today and let us attack your air conditioning needs. 225-222-3332.
Well, this is getting to be crunch time for the return to school here in Tangipahoa. Nobody knows that any better than Tom Tolar, president of the school board. I hear you're speaking to the Ameed Rotary. Give us a preview. Where do we stand for the fall reopening right now?
Everything still, we have a plan set up. I encourage all the viewers to go to the website for the Tangipahoa Parish School System. Look at the plan. You know, we have a plan set up for whether we're in phase one, phase two, or phase three, which is dictated by the state. Right now we're in phase two, so that plan is in place where K through six will be traditional school in-house with a lot of safety precautions in place. The teachers are getting familiar with all the different things as far as washing every 2 hours, washing their hands, the 50% capacity of our school buses, all those things. But the biggest thing is the 7 through 12 is going to be strictly virtual as we start school in August. We know we have a lot of hurdles to jump for that. The administration is working overtime to try to iron out all this. The schools are working to come up with their plans to issue out the Chromebooks for high school students. Learning has to continue. And no matter what state, no matter what phase we're in at the state level, we as a school system have to provide an equitable education for our students. So we will start in phase two, which will be K through six in the classroom, in their chairs, with some modifications and safety things in place. And then with the 7 through 12, full virtual.
And you would expect that that'll change as the year goes on.
Absolutely. That will change hopefully soon. You know, everybody has different opinions about the masks. They have different opinions about the testing and the amount of testing and the validity of the testing. But we have to go by the data that we receive. As soon as we can get 7 through 12 back in the classroom, the better it will be for all of us. We all agree. The administrators, and I can't speak for all the principals and the teachers, but I'm pretty sure most would agree that children learn better in the classroom, sitting in the chair, working with the teacher rather than virtual. Virtual is a way to do it, but we want our kids back in school.
And you know what concerns me is knowing how things actually work. The best students from the best families, I'm certain they'll do great. Right. With virtual learning. It's the kids at risk, it's the handicapped children, the ones from the poorest families. You have to wonder how they're going to make out.
Well, we have students with IEPs, which is, you know, either any type of learning disability or a special plan for their learning situation. We have special ed teachers that are going to have to reach out to those students on a daily basis, on a weekly basis, to make sure they're getting what they need. Or some of those students may be required to be in our school system, in our buildings, even in the 7th through 12th grade. So there's still a lot of little issues like that that we're trying to work out. But, yeah, you know, when I went back to Southeastern to finish my degree, I had to take a lot of online classes because I was working. And at first I thought that was going to be easy, but there are some classes that were really hard online, and it took a lot of discipline to sit down and spend the time in front of a computer that you would normally spend in front of a teacher sitting at a desk. Expecting all kids to be that disciplined, to sit down and spend the quality time with their computer that they need to do this work, we understand that that's going to be difficult. The teachers are going to be tasked with reaching out and having contact with those students to make sure they're progressing well. There's going to be benchmarks that they have to make in their classes to make sure that they keep up with their work. And parents are going to be more involved to try to make sure that little Johnny and little Sally are doing the work that they need to do.
Well, nobody knows any better than you about a rural area. You have perhaps the most rural district in the parish, and not everybody has good Wi-Fi.
Absolutely. Almost my entire district is rural without good internet service. We are making hotspots available. There's a link on the website that parents can go to if they don't have internet access at their house and they do have cell phone service. Then there's hotspots that we can provide them with so that they can stay connected.
That's still not as good as internet.
That's still not as good. It's still internet access. It's not as fast as what we would like. Even, you know, our church is in downtown Kentwood. And when we started doing live streaming, when our quality outdid our bandwidth, we had to step up and go from DSL to fiber just because of bandwidth and because of the quality. So we understand that, but with what we're requiring them to do, they don't need a lot of bandwidth. We're not talking about streaming videos or uploading videos. We're talking about data up and down. So most people can have access, even with a phone, most people can have access by going to our website and going through the different portals to get to learning. So, you know, if someone doesn't have it, though, we can provide them with hotspot.
What about the K through 6 children? There's some concern that there won't be enough school buses or bus drivers to transport them.
There is a transportation survey right now, and I think we're about half of our parents have filled it out. Parish-wide, I encourage all parents to get online, fill out the transportation survey, because what that survey is telling us is how many children need to be on a bus. We have some parents that are able to take their kids to school, and that's great, and we're encouraging that. Because our buses at 50% capacity, we cannot get everyone to school that we traditionally get to school. So each school is going to be a little bit different as far as when they reach those numbers. But when a bus is at 50% capacity, we have to figure something else out. So I encourage people to go do the transportation survey so we can find out. For instance, if we have a school where we can get all of the, where seventh graders or eighth graders can start going back to school, we can revisit those. And that's why this plan is going to be continually adjusted. As we go forward, we're hoping to include more students back into the classroom as soon as we can get more transportation.
On the other hand, you know, we could slide backwards, and there is some data to support that we will.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, of course, in our phase one plan, which is back where it was at in March and April of this year, it would be everyone would be full virtual. There'll be no one in the classroom. And we hope that does not happen.
What are some other issues that are still outstanding?
Well, obviously, you know, have people that are upset about athletics. We have people that are, and rightfully so, we have people that are concerned about their children. Mom and dad both work. Mom and dad are expecting their children to go to school and not be at home during the day. And, you know, everybody can argue back and forth about how old you can be whenever every child's different. Some seventh graders may worry their parents by being home all day doing their virtual work online. So we understand every family has a situation. I have friends that work in Baton Rouge that leave before their children get on a bus, and they're concerned about two of their kids are going to be going to school and two of their kids are not going to be going to school. And every family, there's a different situation. And by all means, we all want our children back in school, sitting in a desk in front of a teacher. We just have to wait till we can actually meet that requirement.
What about athletics? I mean, it sounds as though it'll be few, if any.
Well, like the Athletic Association has said, you know, that not until phase four. We don't know how long that's going to take to get there. We don't know if that's going to mean they can still, obviously, they're still practicing, they're still preparing, they're still working out. A lot of the teams are. But, yeah, football could be moved. We have a later start, which right now it's so hot that I don't think fans would care about a later start. But, you know, athletics, some people look at it and say, well, that's not the important thing to worry about. But there's a lot of athletes in our school system that are still going to school because of athletics. And I hate to say that, but I hate to see our dropout rate increase because people reach the 12th grade and they say, well, you know, I can't play athletics, so I might as well just go ahead and enter the workforce. We don't want to see that happen. We want to provide them with a full-rounded education with athletics.
But if kids are not going to high school, how can you expect a team to practice?
That's a lot of questions. You know, right now the plan still calls for they can still participate in athletics, but I don't know how this is going to work moving in the fall. And I'm just assuming that that's once they put out the, we're not in the driver's seat on that. The High School Athletic Association will be the ones that will tell us and dictate when we can start playing, when we can start practicing, when we can start having traditional athletics.
What else do you want to share with us?
There's just a lot of things that are coming downstream. And, you know, I've heard other board members say this. I encourage everyone to go to our Tangi Schools website. Look at the website. There's tons of good information. The frequently asked questions is the most popular page right now, and it needs to be, because for all those parents that are calling me, I love getting the calls and I love answering the questions. But if they will take the time to pull up that frequently asked page and go through the questions, there's a lot of questions on there, good questions that parents and faculty, teachers, administrators have put on there with good answers that will help sum this up. And that's the best place to get the information from, is from our website.
Hi, I'm Chase Sharkey with Sharkey Mechanical. Our team of experts handles some of the largest and most complex air conditioning systems in the state. Give us a call today and let us attack your air conditioning needs. 225-222-3332.